What is up, boys? Quacker Smacker is back in action. We have a little bit different scenery today. We are in the port of the air. We are in the airport. I've got a new guy I'm hunting with. Actually, two new guys. One I've met, one I haven't met. But as you know, I'm a student at Liberty University. Met this guy named Nick. The last name's Lyon, right?
Yes.
Nick Lyon. Met him about a week and a half ago. Turns out he was going on an elk hunt. I'm like, dang.
Final call for Pellegrino.
Point is, meet this guy. He's like, yeah, I'm going to Colorado for this hunt. I'm like, sweet, that sounds sick. I'm probably not going to be able to make it work. I have school. I have an obligation. Bam, I make it work. Get the ticket a couple days ago. We're heading to Colorado for a huge hunt. We're getting after it. We're going to be in the woods for like
7 days.
7 days. Yeah. We're going to be in the woods for 7 days. Backpacking. We got food. We got water. Well, the water's there, but we got to filter all that jazz. But I'll give you the whole setup once we get out there. But the first day is going to be, we're going to get as far as possible. We're going to be setting up tents every night. So it's not like we'll have one base camp. We'll be packing up, moving on, you know, elk here, they're bedding down, bam. We're going to sleep next to them, sleep in their house, you know what I mean? Let me introduce you to my guy, Nick, right here.
Good morning.
He's ready to be fired up.
Kill it.
I'm ready to kill it. He's ready to kill it. Hopefully, yeah. Kev's ready to kill it. We're going to throw the camera away, like I already said. We're going to hop on the plane. So I'll see you boys in Colorado. All right, boys, we made it to the hotel, motel, Holiday Inn, if you will. We are at the Country Lodge. Place is absolutely banging. I'm going to have Nick, who's back here, he has all of his stuff out. He's doing a little pack dump. So he's basically going to go through and say, like, you know, this is our food. This is how we are surviving with water. This is blah, blah. So he's going to go through all the gear that will actually be in the pack. And I'm going to let him do the explaining because he knows much more about it than I do. So take it away, Mr. Nicholas.
Absolutely. So pack dumps are a thing we do basically every day, probably about 3 times a day while we're out there. So you get used to unpacking and repacking your bag, so you know what everything is and where everything goes. This is my food bag, but it has a zip up here because it's easy to get into. In there's 21 freeze-dried meals, so it's really easy to eat, super tasty. This has got all my clothes, everything I need while I'm out there. Don't cheap out on a sleeping bag. So we got a good sleeping bag. We got the old MSR. This bad boy is a one-person tent called the Hubba. In terms of food, where's my jet boil? Here it is. This bad boy does it all. Boils water in less than a minute, puts water in your freeze-dried meals, makes everything awesome. In terms of the pack, this is it. This is the Kyu 7,000 cubic inch liter, something or other. But it gets it done. It's got the bow holder here, so the bow sits on the back. Best pack I've ever owned. First pack I've ever owned, so I can't really say much to that. That's about it. That's my pack dump. So, viewers, what we're doing here is we're sighting in Kevin's bow. Now, most elk hunters, they sight their bows in months in advance. They're doing it all wrong.
Yeah, they don't know what they're talking about.
See, the
about.
Altitude changes how the strings, you know, the reverb and all that stuff. You know, it all adds up. So it's really important to do a little test and tune right here, exactly. Right at altitude.
Currently 6:55.
We got an hour and a half drive to the old juicer.
Got some good sleep. Probably got what? You said 6 miles today? Going up in elevation.
Nothing we can't handle.
Good morning. We're here at the spot. It is packed, actually. We saw a total of what? 10, 12? 20 cars, a little busy. Kevin's throwing on his 60-pound monster. And yeah, we're about to shoot some bows and then hit the trail.
How you feeling?
Feeling pretty good. We're like, probably half a mile in here.
About at least a mile.
Probably like 8,000 feet.
Yeah, there's a little pond up here.
Cool little beaver dam. Got a nice view.
Yeah.
We're walking up. We're almost about like 3.5 miles in. Out of 6 miles to go, we just glance over at Kevin, looks over, and he sees this little herd of elk. And we stopped, took the packs off, started to glass them, look at them. And then two hunters show up right behind us. They're super cool. Good guys to talk to. But we got to keep rolling. It's a good sign that we've seen elk already. They're all cows, unfortunately, but considering that we're not that far in, elk now. I like it.
After about 7 hours of hiking, and how many thousand feet, Kevin? 9,000 and change, huh?
I think we're at 9,600.
Doesn't seem like a lot, but your body will feel it. So we made it up here, it's 6 o'clock. We're just setting up tent, and we're gonna get some grub in us, hit the hay early, and hopefully hear some bugles at night. So, good night.
I had a muscle hurt, so it sounded like a cow that way, so we're gonna go check it out.
That's so awesome.
So we stopped here to glass for a little bit. Haven't actually seen any elk, but we just heard a bugle all off on its own. We didn't even initiate it. So we called back. Elk bugled back. Gave it a minute, called again. Elk bugled. We did that back and forth maybe 4 or 5 times, I think. So we think we got somebody who's a little riled up over there. And we're gonna keep moving along this ridge up here. We're gonna bugle every once in a while. Let that elk know we're getting close to him. Hopefully he'll get mad. We'll be able to piss him off enough to come to us. We'll smoke him.
Well, boys, it's day two. We made it to the camp spot. We got a beautiful glassing spot. We're gonna go check out in a second, but we're gonna go ahead and set up camp. This hike was not even close to as bad as the first one. Day one was tragic, but we're about ready to get some hunting down. We heard some bugles along the ride here, if you will, but you already probably saw that. So yeah, we're gonna set up camp here, and then we're gonna head up, do some glassing probably for, you know, hopefully we see that elk that was giving us the old works. So your boy's gonna put up the camera and set up the tent and call it a day, and we'll get some lunch. See you boys on top of the mountain.
Well, boys, as you can tell, she's raining. Sure hope this guy holds up. Let me show you this setup. Here's this guy. I got the camera bag, Glock, of course.
my stuff's in here. I think it is, you know? You want a little bit of water, you just grab this guy. Put it up to the mouth.
Gotta have a leaf shot. Oh,
no. Oh. Wow. That's great.
So, you're probably wondering who this is. Well, this is Brant. Before it started to rain, we bumped into this guy. He said he was a solo hunter, and we were just shooting the breeze for a little bit. And then, we saw a nasty cloud. It was going to rain, so our camp was not too far. He was a solo guy. He came and camped with us while it was raining. And then after the rain, the sun was going down. So we went to our glassing spot, glassed for a little bit. And then what happens next is pretty, pretty incredible.
All right, boys. Probably haven't picked up, well, I actually haven't picked up the camera since last night. Let me just give you a quick little rundown. So basically, we had like maybe an hour and a half before shooting light. We got up on this little mountaintop to scout. Nobody had their bows. I didn't have the camera. We were just going to scout, see if we could see one bedding down, maybe for the next day or whatever. Well, we see one bed down like super early, where we still have like over an hour to make a play.
Yo, you want to stay there or you want to go? Yeah, you can if you want. Just dump that back, bro.
Long story short, we're like pretty far from camp and like over these rocks. So I'm like, I'm not going back for the camera. It's not worth. Don't really know what's gonna happen. Nobody has the bow, so Nick crawls back over the rocks to get his bow. He gets his bow. We make a play. We go down this little mountain.
We either call or we'll just push. Just do a lap and I'll probably leave you at that point and let you go.
Last light, we're creeping up on this bull, and the guy, we actually don't know his name, believe it or not, which is really bad, but I'm just gonna call him the dude. So the dude and I are cruising down this hill. He's up on top, he's behind me, and I'm sneaking up, and the bull elk, he hears us, so he does a bark. By this tree, this last light, and I pull out my rangefinder. I'm like ranging anything I could see. My rangefinder is like 6 years old and it's like black, so it's been like 75 maybe. So I just get one mark at 75, and then bull comes out around the corner, and now I'm frozen. You know, I got the bow here, I got the release ready, and the bull is, you know, facing me, looking up the hill at the dude. You know, so I'm like, you know, I can't draw while he's looking at me. So I'm just waiting until he one time dipped his head. And so I drew back, steadied my breath, and just sent the most beautiful shot I've ever sent. Everything was choice. The release, all of it, except one thing. He wasn't at what I presume 65 yards. He was at a downhill slope at 50. So I put my pin on him, 65, but at a even on a level ground at 50 yards, that arrow would have just crested his back, unfortunately. So it was so dark, we couldn't even tell if it hit him. It made it sound like it did, but we're very sure it just went right over his back. And, you know, he spooked, buggered off, and we couldn't tell what happened. It was so dark. But unfortunately, I missed that bullet. It's a weird mix of emotions of both, like, I'm super stoked that I got that close and I actually had an opportunity at a bull. But I'm also super pissed because I had an opportunity at a bull and I missed. And it was brutal. But, I mean, all the reps by just shooting, I was in the moment. I wasn't even thinking about my shot or anything. It was just muscle memory at that point, which was awesome, except for the fact that I couldn't judge how far away that pole was, which killed me. So I think the dude's coming right now. So catch you later.